Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming to the fourth session. Let's get started. Dr. Bhate is also here. Dr. Bhate, please start.
Okay, next. Next slide, please. Next. Om Sahanavavatu. सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः नेक्स्ट उद्यम साहसं धैर्यं बुद्धिशक्तिः पराक्रमः षडेते यत्र वर्तन्ते तत्र साहाय्यकृद् विधिः यत्र उद्यमः साहसं धैर्यं बुद्धिः शक्तिः पराक्रमः एते षड् वर्तन्ते तत्र विधिः साहाय्यकृद् सो दिस् इस् दि अन्वय in a sentence form. Wherever these six exist, which are those six? Udyama, industriousness, sahasa, adventurous spirit, dhairya, steadfastness, buddhi, intelligence, shakti, power, parakrama, valor, so whenever these six are there, fortune is bound to help a person. So this is a stanza which tells you that there is something other than fortune, other than luck, which is really required. So you just don't depend upon your fortune, but if you are industrious, if you do efforts, then only you can achieve success in this life.
Dr. Bhate, there is one question. Dhairya is courage or steadfast, not patience. I guess in the meaning they have written is written it that way. So that was a question.
Yes, actually dhairya is steadfastness. Dhira is a steadfast person. But these are different nuances in which this word is also used at different places. It depends upon the context in which you use the word. And therefore I translated it here as steadfastness.
Okay, there is another question. What is the significance of krid after sahaya?
Okay, sahaya krid is a compound, and krut is derived from the root kru, which means to do. So sahaya krut can be rendered as sahayam karoti, asau karoti iti, one who gives help. This is the literal translation. Sahaya is help, krut means gives, makes. So sahaya krut means one which helps. That which helps. So this is an adjective of vidhi. Sahayam karoti. Vidhihi sahayam karoti. This is the meaning of this expression. So krut is a verbal form. And it is attached to the word sahaya, and it becomes a compound. You have also to note the word sahaya. Generally we use sahaya, which is not correct. It should be sahaya. Okay.
Okay.
नेक्स्ट न कश्चिदपि जानाति किं कस्य श्वो भविष्यति अत श्वः करणीयानि कुर्यादद्यैव बुद्धिमान् सो इफ इफ द ऑडियंस इज इंडियन दे प्रोबेबली नो द दोहा ऑफ कबीर काल करे सो आज कर, आज करे सो अब, वट एवर यू वॉन्ट टू डू टुमारो यू डू इट टूडे इट सेल्फ एंड वट एवर यू वॉन्ट टू डू टूडे यू डू इट राइट नाउ. वाई? बिकॉज कस्य श्वः किं भविष्यति न कश्चिदपि जानाति. नो बडी नोज वट विल हैपन टू हिम टुमारो एंड देयर फॉर वट एवर यू हैव पोस्टपोन फॉर टुमारो डू इट टूडे इट सेल्फ. अतः श्वः करणीयानि. बुद्धिमान अद्यैव कुर्यात्. बुद्धिमान, अ वाइज पर्सन शुड डू टुडे इट्सेल्फ. अद्यैव, टुडे इट्सेल्फ. श्वः करणीयानि, वट एवर ही वॉन्ट्स टू डू टुमारो.
नो क्वेश्चंस ऑन दिस.
ओके. दानं भोगो नाशस्तिस्रो गतयो भवन्ति वित्तस्य, यो न ददाति न भुङ्क्ते तस्य तृतीया गतिर्भवति. यू माइट हैव कम अक्रॉस सिमिलर वर्सेस आल्सो प्रोबेबली इन द प्रीवियस सेशंस, बट देर आर क्वाइट अ फ्यू वर्सेस अबाउट वेल्थ एंड देर इज ऑलवेज एन एम्फोसिस ऑफ ऑन गिविंग अवे द वेल्थ एंड नॉट इन्वेस्टिंग मनी. So here he says there are three ways in which wealth is disposed. Dana, bhoga, nasha. Danam, bhogaha, nashaha, iti vittasya tisraha gatayaha bhavanti. Yaha na dadati, na bhunte, tasya trutiya gatir bhavati. One who does not give dana, one who does not enjoy the wealth, bhoga, obviously for him it is the third way. The wealth, his wealth goes the third way. And what is the third way? Nasha. Because he just invests money in a bank and one fine morning he is no more and that bank money goes, one doesn't know where. So this is the importance of course dana, but at the same time you should also enjoy whatever you have earned. This bhunkte in the verse, I think the dot between this da like letter is missing. It should be there. You can see it in the glossary, but it is slightly visible in the text of the verse. So please take note of this. Otherwise, it appears like bhudukte, which is not good, not correct. So it is ng, and not da. So I think there is no compound. The verse is very easy.
There is one question. What is the meaning of tisra?
Tisra is three. Tisra is a nominative plural in feminine of the noun three. Three means three, and here it is an adjective of gatayaha. Gati is a feminine word, and therefore tisraha is a feminine nominative plural. Masculine would be trayaha. So, in Sanskrit, according to the gender, the form of the word changes. It's a feminine form.
Okay, thank you. There's one more question. Can we know the time of this, when this was created?
It should be later on the basis of this meter. This is this is Arya meter. Yeah, of course, I will once again confirm it. As I told you, I will write a separate note on the meters, not now. And this meter was introduced rather late. And therefore it appears to be a late. And as I told you, it's very difficult to decide the dates of these verses unless they come from very well-known authors like Kalidasa and Bhasa. They are just floating verses, so you cannot fix the dates. It's only on the basis of their meter or their wording that you can approximately decide the date. So it appears to be later, of course. You know, even in 20th century, verses have been incorporated into Subhashitas.
There is one comment from Rashmi. There is a reference to this verse in Panchatantra, Mitra Samprapti.
Yes. Yes, okay.
Just a comment from her.
Okay, fine. But you know, Panchatantra also, maybe the core was written long, long back. But it went on, you know, growing. The text went on growing, so you never know when this particular verse was incorporated. This is, you know, this very special feature of Sanskrit literature. Sanskrit literature, all these texts, they were written at a point of a time. And then there were many additions and omissions carried on through the centuries. And we never know what the original text was. Sometimes it is possible to reach the original. But even then we are not sure. So it is not certain that the author of Panchatantra himself wrote the verse. Because there are, you know, a series of verses incorporated in Panchatantra. So, okay, it is there in Panchatantra. Fine. Okay?
Yeah. No more questions.
Okay. Shama Shastram Kareyasya Durjanah Kinkarishyati Atrune Patito Vanhihi Swayamevo Pashamyati. So this is in praise of tolerance, forgiveness. One should always have forgiveness in his life. And in that case, he has no enemy at all. Yasya kare shama shastram. Tasya durjanaha kim karishyati. Yatha, so an illustration. Atrune patitaha vanhi swayameva upashamyati. One in whose hand tolerance, forgiveness is the weapon for him. There is nobody who is a wicked person. He has no enemy. Such as, for example, fire which falls on a place where there is no grass extinguishes itself. So there is no, the fire doesn't work at all. So even if Durjana is angry and he tries to fight with that person, if the person remains calm, it's of no use. This is a very simple meaning. So one should try to develop this virtue of forgiveness. Swayam eva upashamyati. Swayam eva upashamyati, sir. Atruna is again a compound. Na trunam atrunam or na trunam yatra tad atrunam. That place where there is no grass. Of course, by truna we have to understand dry grass, because that gets fire. That catches fire.
Next.
Yeah.
Yes. No. क्षणशः कणशश्चैव विद्यामर्थं च साधयेत् क्षणत्यागे कुतो विद्या कणत्यागे कुतो धनम्. सो हाउ शुड वन अक्वायर नॉलेज एंड वेल्थ इन हिज लाइफ. क्षण मूवमेंट बाय मूवमेंट क्षणशः विद्यां साधयेत् कणशः अर्थं साधयेत्. दिस इज हाउ वी हैव टू कंस्ट्रू इट. क्षणशः विद्यां कणशः अर्थं च साधयेत्. वाय क्षणत्यागे कुतो विद्या कणत्यागे कुतो धनम्. सो इफ यू जस्ट गिव अप अ मूमेंट, नो नॉलेज. सो डोंट लूज अ सिंगल मूमेंट इन अक्वायरिंग नॉलेज. डोंट लूज अ सिंगल ड्रॉप, अ सिंगल व्हाट शुड आई से, बिंदु, बिट, व्हेन यू आर ट्राइंग टू अक्वायर वेल्थ. क्षणशः कणशः. दिस इज वेरी वेरी ट्रू As far as Vidya, it has been my own experience throughout my life. Okay? Any question?
No questions.
So very simple. I can just comment on the sandhi here, kuto vidya and kuto dhanam. Perhaps you are now already aware of this change of visarga into o. Kutaha is the original word. It is an avyaya, indeclinable. And this visarga, kutaha, becomes kuto because it is followed by a consonant. Kuto vidya, kuto dhanam, dho and vi. That we have to remember. Similarly, kranashash chaiva also is kranashaha cha eva. So the visarga here changes into sha. So visarga takes different appearances in sandhi. Here it becomes sha. In the latter case it becomes o. Sometimes it is dropped. Many. And sometimes it becomes ra. Udyamena hi. Are there any questions?
No questions, sorry.
Okay. Udyamena hi siddhyanti karyani namanorathaihi nahi suptasya simhasya pravishanti mukham rugaha. So this verse again is in praise of effort. These subhashitas are actually meant for children. Not for grown-up persons, of course, but those who have forgotten these things throughout their life, this is a kind of a reminder. But actually they are meant for small children, how they should undertake efforts. Udyamenahi karyani siddhyanti na manorathaihi. Like Sheikh Muhammad, that famous story, everyone knows it. You just cannot go on daydreaming. That will not really achieve anything for you. Udyamenahi siddhanti, unless you undertake efforts, whatever you want to achieve is accomplished. Na manorathahi, not just by entertaining dreams. Nahi suptasya simhasya mukham mrugaha pravishanti. A lion sleeping and an animal entering its mouth, you have never seen. So even a lion has to do efforts. He has to kill the animal himself.
There's one question. Should it be mukham mrugaha or mukhe mrugaha?
There are two different readings of this verse. A very right question. But actually when it is, the verb is pravishanti, you also can use mukham accusative. But in some texts it is also mentioned as mukhe mrugaha. But mukham is correct according to me. It is an object.
Sharad is asking pretty much the same question, but he is saying, does the verb pravishanti take the saptami or dvitiya of mukham?
Dvitiya it should. Dvitiya it should, because pravishanti is a kind of a word which conveys some kind of gati. Movement. So whatever verb conveys movement, going, action of going, that always governs accusative, and therefore it is accusative.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. प्रियवाक्य प्रदानेन सर्वे तुष्यन्ति जन्तवः तस्मात् तदेव वक्तव्यं वचने का दरिद्रता. One should always speak pleasant words. One should always speak in such a way that it pleases the listener. प्रियवाक्य प्रदानेन सर्वे जन्तवः तुष्यन्ति. Literally it means by giving a pleasant vakya means a sentence. I'm just translating it literally. By giving a pleasant sentence, all creatures are satisfied, they become very happy. And therefore, tasmat tadeva vaktavyam, one should try to speak that alone. That is a pleasing word alone. Vachane ka daritra. Why should there be poverty, scarcity in speaking pleasantly? Vachane ka daridrata has been a very common phrase, and often it is also used as vachane kim daridrata, which is not correct. So it should be vachane ka daridrata.
There is one comment, I don't know if you would know right away, that there is another conflicting sloka which says that you should tell the truth no matter how harsh it is.
Yes, yes, yes. I think perhaps we have come across that word, that verse earlier. But yes, there is. And there are quite a few other verses also. This is again another very special feature of Subhashitas, and that is they speak contrary things also. Well, here, strictly speaking, it's not contrary. Priyam Vaktavyam and Hitam Vaktavyam. Huh? So, what the person who asked the question means is that one should speak truth and at the same time which pleases. And then, apriyasya cha patyasya vakta shrota cha durlabha. This verse I vaguely remember, we have already come across. So it is very difficult to speak truth and at the same time speak what pleases the listener, because truth is always bitter. Yes, there is this verse, but he here says priya vakyam vaktavyam. So priyam vaktavyam, either it is satya or asatya, he doesn't say anything. So it's not a contrary verse. It only says that one should always speak in a pleasing manner. Well, it depends upon your style. You may tell the truth in a pleasing manner also, very skillfully, though the truth is very bitter. But it is true that there are such verses.
Like Ma Bruyat Satyam Apriyam, something was there, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The same thing, yes. Satyam Bruyat Priyam Bruyat.
Okay.
Ma Bruyat Satyam Apriyam.
Can you explain that one, please, a little bit?
Yes, yes, sure. Satyam bruyat, priyam bruyat, ma bruyat, satyam apriyam. One should speak truth, and one should speak in a pleasant manner. Ma bruyat, satyam apriyam, but one should not speak truth, which is not pleasing. So here, he is very much emphasizing on priya. Yat satyam apriyam tad na bruyat. Whatever is truth but not pleasant should not be communicated, he says. But it, you know, if you cannot follow this in actual life. If there is truth and if it is bitter, and if you cannot communicate it in a very pleasant manner, you have to communicate it. So I have also quoted the other line, apriyasya cha patyasya vakta shrota cha durlabha. The speaker as well as the listener of that which is not pleasant but at the same time very beneficial is very rare. So everyone wants to listen to something pleasing, at the same time it is beneficial, is very rarely found. So about speech, there are quite a few verses in Subhashita collections. And sometimes they do speak opposite things.
Next.
Yeah. Sulabah purusha aloke satatam priyavadinah apriyasya cha patyasya vakta shrota cha durlabha. I have just explained it. So, in this world, loke, सततम प्रियवादिनः पुरुषाः सुलभाः. पीपल ऑलवेज टॉकिंग इन अ प्लेजेंट मैनर आर वेरी इजी टू बी फाउंड इन दिस वर्ल्ड. सततम प्रियवादिनः पुरुषाः अस्मिन् लोके सुलभाः. बट अप्रियस्य च पथ्यस्य वक्ता श्रोता च दुर्लभा. वन हू स्पीक्स अप्रिय एज वेल एज पथ्य एट द सेम टाइम एंड वन हू लिसन्स टू अप्रिय एंड पथ्य इज अ वेरी रेयर पर्सन. सो नोबडी वॉन्ट्स टू स्पीक विच इज बेनिफिशियल बट एट द सेम टाइम नॉट प्लीजिंग. नोबडी वॉन्ट्स टू हियर विच इज beneficial but not pleasing. Apriyasya cha pathyasya. Pathya, here it is not truth but it is pathya, that is what is beneficial.
There is one comment.
Yes.
Didn't we do this one in lesson one? I don't think it was exactly this one, but there was some Subhashit similar to this one that we
quite likely, and I don't remember. We will have to find out. But it's quite likely, and as you said also, it's quite likely that similar thing we have already done.
Yep. Okay, no more questions.
Okay. ज्येष्ठत्वं जन्मना नैव गुणैर्ज्येष्ठत्वमुच्यते गुणाद् गुरुत्वमायाति दुग्धं दधि घृतं क्रमात्. सो ज्येष्ठत्व हियर इज टू बी अंडरस्टूड इन द सेंस ऑफ सुपीरियरिटी. ज्येष्ठ एक्चुअली मीन्स द एल्डेस्ट, वन हू इज द एल्डेस्ट बाय एज, बट ऑल्सो वन हू इज superior. So jeshtatvam naiva janmana, jeshtatvam gunaihi uchyate. So you cannot decide superiority of a person on the basis of his birth. Because he is born in a high class, he should not be understood as a superior person. But it is the virtues, the qualities which he possesses that make him superior. Gunai hi jeshtatvam uchyate. And he gives an illustration, drushtanta. It is called drushtanta, illustration. Example, dugdham dadhi ghrutam kramat gunat gurutvam ayati. First it is milk, then it becomes curd, and finally it becomes ghruta, ghee. So the gurutva, heaviness, jeshtatva is on account of the virtues. Not a really happy illustration, you know. But sometimes these composers of Subhashitas, they give such illustrations from common ordinary life, and we have to accept them. But the, you know, the essence is to be understood. Dugdha is very diluted, it's a liquid entity, and then comes dadhi, which is semi-solid, and gruta is solid. Actually gruta also is not solid to that extent, and this is because of the qualities, he says. It's a very good verse, because although Indian culture, Indian tradition is known to have given emphasis to jati, caste system, there are verses which speak against casteism. So janmana jeshtatvam naiva is a very important thing.
There is one comment from Rashmi. Respect has to be commanded, not demanded.
Sorry, I could not get it.
Respect has to be commanded, not demanded.
Yeah, that's right. That's perfectly right. But this is not what is meant by this verse.
Is it
this verse? Sorry. Yeah, yeah.
Is it similar to what Karna says in Mahabharata, Daivayattam Kule Janma Madayattam
Yes.
Purusham?
Exactly. I was reminded of that also, but it is not in Mahabharata. It is in one of the Sanskrit dramas called Veni Samhara.
Oh, I see.
So Karna does say there, Daivayattam Kule Janma Madayattam Tu Purusham. Yeah, very right. So here the emphasis is on you cannot decide your superiority on the basis of the family in which you are born. You know, commanding and demanding is of course there, but it has a different context also. Even if you are superior, and if you find that they are not respecting you, and if you ask for it, then it is demanding. Sometimes we see around us such people are there. But Rashmi's comment is also very appropriate in this context.
Okay, no more questions on this.
Okay, next. Dharmaya yashasye arthaya kamaya svajanaya cha panchadha vibhajan vittam ihamutra cha modate. Now look here, the use of wealth distributed over five different purposes has been described. Earlier danam bhogo nasha, only three, and now it is five here. So it is, you know, the imagination of the composer of the Subhashita which works. So here he gives five ways of distributing earths. Dharmaya yashase arthaya kamaya svajanaya cha panchadha vittam vibhajan iha amutra cha modate. A person who distributes his wealth over these five things is always happy, ever happy, both in this world as well as in the next world. Amutra. Let me first go to the gloss. I had made that correction, but it is not incorporated here. Amutra should be corrected to amutra in the gloss. Please note that. Okay. So one should take a part of his wealth separate for religious purposes. He should use a part to achieve success in his life. Then arthaya artha, that is very important. Vittam, for the sake of vitta. So even these Subhashitakaras, it seems that they believed in investment. To earn money out of money, arthaya. And then kama is any kind of pleasure, enjoyment. If you want to enjoy your life, you should also use a part of money for enjoyment. And svajanaya, also make use of the money for all your people, your relatives and your friends. These are the five ways in which money should be spent. And such person is happy in this world as well as in the other world, that means after death. Life, there is life after death, according to Hinduism. So he is happy even that, because he makes use of a part of his money for dharma, for religious practices.
There is one question about the grammar. How does the sentence get completed here grammatically?
Actually it is complete. Okay. Dharmaya yashase arthaya kamaya svajanaya cha iti panchadha vibhajan panchadha vittam vibhajan iha cha modate amutra cha modate. So actually what is missing in this sentence is only the agent. So you can say naraha purushaha naraha modate. So there is a verb here, modate, एंड स्वजनाय कामाय अर्थाय यशसे एंड धर्माय दीज आर डेटिव सिंगुलर्स एंड दे ओनली मीन फॉर द सेक ऑफ धर्म फॉर द सेक ऑफ लाइक दिस फॉर द सेक ऑफ यशस सक्सेस इन लाइफ फॉर द सेक ऑफ अर्थ फॉर द सेक ऑफ काम एंड फॉर द सेक ऑफ वन्स ओन पीपल पंचधा विभजन डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिंग इन दिस फाइव वे Could the person who is asking the question, my friend, explain what exactly is the difficulty in understanding the grammar?
So then I will. His name is Sharad. He is asking what form is the vibhajan?
Okay, vibhajan is a present participle, Sharad. Panchadha vibhajan means one who distributes. Vibhajan, vibhajate asau vibhajan. One who distributes. And vibhajan is an adjective of purushaha. So this purusha, which is an agent, is missing here. Panchadha vibhajan purushaha modate. So vibhajan should be treated here as the agent itself. Distributor, you can say, I mean literal translation will be distributor in five ways. But it is an adjective of purushaha, a person.
Deglurgar? There is one Yagnesh Shah who has raised his hand. Do you want to unmute him? Shall I do?
Yeah, 1 minute I will.
Okay. I think he's first in the list, I saw.
1 minute, I'll be there. Go ahead, Yagnesh.
I was thinking that since we are talking about distributing the wealth and one of the reason the five ways we can distribute the wealth. The one of the fifth ways is also wealth. So where is the actual fifth ways here?
Dharma, yashas, artha, kama and svajana. They are the five ways.
Oh, okay, so in the explanation of English, I think we probably have to make some changes there.
Righteous deed, success, wealth, sensual pleasure, and one's own relatives. So five are there.
Wealth comes again as a distributing wealth.
Yes, wealth for the sake of wealth. So what he wants to say is that you should distribute the whole wealth among these five aspects. Wealth for wealth is one purpose. Wealth for dharma is another purpose. And therefore the wealth is mentioned there. Wealth is one of the five aspects of distribution of wealth.
Like you said, it should be reinvested kind of thing, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
You should use your money also to gain money, gain more money.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. No more questions on this.
Okay. येषां बाहुबलं नास्ति येषां नास्ति मनोबलं तेषां चंद्रबलं देव किं कुर्यादंबरस्थितम् दिस इज अ वर्स एड्रेस टू अ किंग देव देव इज यूजुअली एन एड्रेस टू अ किंग सो मे बी देर इज एन एडवाइजर और अ सेज और अ मिनिस्टर टॉकिंग टू अ किंग एंड ही टेल्स द किंग Not to just trust on his horoscope. Chandrabala refers to horoscope. So let me first give the order of the words in a sentence. Yesham bahubalam nasti. Yesham manobalam nasti. Tesham deva ambarasthitam chandrabalam kim kuryat. Deva, O king, those who do not possess bahubala, valor, those who do not possess manobala, you will translate it power of mind or something, maybe some better English you can suggest.
Determination? Manobala. Determination or something?
Determination, yeah, but there are many facets to manobala, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Determination is one of them. Anyhow. And if they don't possess both these things, mental power as well as physical power, if they don't have it, then Chandrabala, the power of moon, which is in the sky cannot achieve anything for them. Probably you know what this power of moon is. It is the position of moon at in a particular house in your horoscope. At the time of a birth of a person, you know, these Jyotishis, they make a horoscope, they prepare a horoscope, and then they fix the position of moon at the time of the birth in the sky. So moon was in which Rashi, in which place that is found. And if the moon is found to be in certain places, it is regarded as very, you know, leading to prosperity. On the contrary, if it is found at certain other places, it leads to destruction also. So at the time of fixing a marriage, usually when they look at the horoscope, they also see where the Chandra stands in the horoscope. Chandra Bala. And I'm sure those who know this Hindu way of marriage, they know this verse. Tara Balam Chandra Balam Tadeva Vidya Balam Daiva Balam Tadeva. If you remember that, usually those Vedics, when they recite the mantras, at the end of the whole recitation, they recite this mantra.
Just before they garland each other, right?
Yeah, before they garland each other.
Okay.
Tara balam chandra balam tadaiva, vidya balam daiva balam tadaiva. I forgot this. Lakshmi pate te indriyugam. Namami, I remember this much.
Some suggestions for Manobal were morale, willpower, and strong mind.
Exactly, willpower is the best, I think. Willpower. I think that is perhaps a good word. Willpower. It's a strength. So what is intended here is the strength. You should have willpower. You should have also physical prowess. And just don't rely on Chandravala. You know, there are verses which also are very highly in praise of horoscope. Daivam. Daivam hi daiva matra. So there are some verses which speak very high of daiva, and there are others which speak against daiva also. So both kind of verses are there.
Can Manobal also be said to be vision? I think that is one of the questions. Or in vision, this case, is it more to do with willpower?
I think willpower is more appropriate in this context. Yeah. Okay. Because a person to be successful in his life, what is required is two kinds of strength. One is physical and the other one is mental. So I don't know if vision can be understood in that way. But I'm sure the purport is understood properly. The meaning is taken well. Is it not?
Okay, no more questions on this one.
No, next. Arabe taiva karmani. श्रांतः श्रांतः पुनः पुनः कर्माण्यारभमानं हि पुरुषं शरीरनिषेवते. So here again the poet says that one should always try to make efforts. It's only by efforts that you achieve success in your life. उद्यमे नहि सिद्ध्यन्ति कार्याणि न मनोरथैः. Similar thing has been stated here. श्रांतः श्रांतः पुनः पुनः कर्माणि आरभेतैव. इवन इफ वन इज टायर्ड, श्रांतः श्रांतः एंड अगेन टायर्ड, टायर्ड एंड टायर्ड एंड टायर्ड एंड टायर्ड, अगेन एंड अगेन, ही शुड अंडरटेक व्हाट ही वांट्स टू अचीव. ही शुड अंडरटेक द वर्क व्हाट ही हैज स्टार्टेड. कर्माणि आरभेत एव, एम्फसिस एव. व्हाई? श्री ही कर्माणि आरभमाणं पुरुषं ही निषेवते. लक्ष्मी, श्री, वेल्थ, प्रॉस्पेरिटी enjoys the company only of that person who undertakes activities and not to a lazy person.
Okay, no questions.
No question, fine. Next. Satyasya vachanam shreyaha satyadapi hitam vadet yadbhuta hitam atyantam etat satyam matam mama. So again about speech. What should one speak? Satyasya vachanam shreyaha. Always talking about truths is shreyas, beneficial, good for life. It leads to well-being. Shreyas is well-being. Satyadapi hitam vadet. Even more than satya, one should always speak. That is beneficial for him. Satyadapi hitam vadet. Yad bhuta hitam etat atyantam satyam matam mamo. Whatever is beneficial for beings is according to me the truth. So this is kind of a definition of truth. Truth is that which is beneficial for people in general. Bhuta, all people. Bhuta matra is to be understood by the word bhuta. Bhuta is not just one single person. You know the difference between prayas and shreyas. Shreyas is that which leads to well-being, and it is connected also with the life after death, whereas prayas is something which is connected only with pleasures in this life. So shreyas leads to well-being after death also. Therefore satya is always shreyas. But even beyond satya there is something which is beneficial, and that one should speak. And there are some stories also in Mahabharata, I mean, of hiding the truths, because that was beneficial at that time.
There's one comment that can you kind of try to re-explain the second line, because the meaning is not very clear.
Okay, okay.
Especially bhuta hitam.
Bhuta hitam is beneficial to people in general, beneficial to people. Bhuta actually means, the word literally means a being. Here it is used in the plural sense, all beings. Bhutaya hitam, bhuta hitam, beneficial to all people. Whatever is beneficial to all people is according to me, mama matam. This is my opinion, he says. Mama matam, my opinion is that whatever is beneficial to all people is the absolute truth. Yat bhuta hitam tat atyantam satyam mama matam. It is my opinion. So that is regarded as the ultimate truth.
So this is the writer's opinion, the author of this particular,
yes,
Subhashita's opinion, correct?
Of course, of course. Whatever Subhashita you come across, that gives the opinion of the poet.
Okay.
You may or you may not accept it.
Okay. There's one more question. Do we know who the author is?
This is probably from Mahabharata, I'm not sure. I will have to check in the Mahabharata Subhashitas. So if it comes from Mahabharata, then it is obviously Vyasa's.
Okay.
There's
one
but
more
you know,
question. Sorry, go ahead.
So about Vyasa and about Mahabharata, just a small tip. We should now also try to understand, also we have a good faith in accepting that Vyasa composed the whole Mahabharata consisting of 100,000 verses. Historically, it is not truth. It was composed by many authors. So even when we say it is in Mahabharata, it is not certain that it comes from Vyasa's pen. It has Mahabharata has in fact many authors. That point also we should keep in mind. In other words, authorship is a very controversial issue in Sanskrit.
There's one more question. Where does etat fit into it? Is it does it apply to satyam or matam?
Yeah, etat satyam. Etat applies to satyam. Let me again give the order. Yat atyantam bhutahitam etat satyam mama matam. That is truth. Etat goes to satyam. That is truth. And this is my opinion, mama matam. Is okay, clear?
Yes, thank you. So I think you've opened a new topic in some sense, Dr. Bhatte, because Raj Menon is asking, do you know any other authors of Mahabharata?
Oh yes, even in Mahabharata itself, there is a mention that Vyasa narrated the whole story of Mahabharata to his 5 disciples, and Vaishampayana was one of them. Vaishampayana narrated the whole story at a particular sacrificial performance. You know, earlier there was a practice of narrating stories, narratives during the sacrificial performance as a kind of an entertainment. So Vaishampayana retold a story which was told to him by his Guru Vyasa. And when Vaishampayana was telling the story, there was Ugrashravas who was sitting in the audience, and the same story is told by Ugrashravas to a larger audience at the sacrifice of Shaunaka. And what Mahabharata we have today is the one told by Ugrashravas. It includes the Mahabharata told by Vaishampayana and includes the Mahabharata told by Vyasa. There is a tradition saying that, and well, there are some evidences also, that the original Mahabharata was called Jaya. So that epic which was composed by Vyasa is just Jaya, and that is the poem of victory. Over this Jaya, Vaishampayana added to this. Vaishampayana added many stories, and to this, and it became Bharata. And this Bharata again grew into Mahabharata by many more stories, many more accounts, and many more didactic materials added by Ugrashravas Sauti Sutaputra. Well, lot of things can be said about Mahabharata. If you want, we can go ahead. So Mahabharata, although tradition believes that it was composed the whole by Vyasa, even within Mahabharata we have some references that it was narrated at least 3 times, and thus it certainly has 3 composers or 3 authors, at least narrators, you can say.
There is one question about this. Is there a particular book which kind of goes into the history of Mahabharata or how it evolved? Do you know any particular?
There is a, you know, critical edition of Mahabharata published by Bhandarkar Oriental Research Institute. The project went on for 50 years, 1919, from 1919 to 1966. And Dr. Sukhtankar, who was the first editor, has written a prolegomena to this critical edition. This prolegomena gives you an idea about how the tradition of the text tradition of Mahabharata developed through the centuries, right from the beginning of first century, because the story of the Mahabharata was being narrated, or it was being sung from house to house, or at the you know, ceremonial places, functions, right from the beginning of the first century. So it went on and on and on and on, and the whole account, then it was written down. It first it was an oral epic, and then it was written down, and when it was written down in different scripts, as many as 8 different scripts, and therefore we have 8 different versions of Mahabharata. The Mahabharata, when we talk of Mahabharata, the next question any researcher would ask, which Mahabharata you mean? Because there are minimum 8 different versions of Mahabharata. And the critical edition is a kind of a, you know, edition which has been arrived at as a common denominator of all these 8 versions. So critical edition is regarded as a standard Mahabharata, and that is extended over 19,000 pages. So it's a different edition. And then there are, you know, regional versions also. There is a South Indian version, there is a North Indian version, there is a version on which Nilakantha wrote his commentary, and so on and so forth. So okay. Mahabharata is a very different, very interesting and intriguing topic. मी आता उघडू शकत नाही बेटा.
I think I'll take 2 last questions on this and then we'll move on. The first one is, could you kind of repeat who Ugrashravas narrated Mahabharata to? Or you mentioned Ugrashravas.
Ugrashravas, yes. Ugrashravas, yeah. Ugrashravas is a name of a Suta Putra, a son of a Suta. And Suta literally means a charioteer. Now in ancient India, there was a practice of these Sutas reciting Mahabharata at functions or even in families, etc. So this Ugrashravas Sauti is a Suta Putra. He was one of the audience of Vaishampayana, when Vaishampayana was narrating the whole story of Mahabharata, as he heard from Vyasa's mouth. Vaishampayana narrated during the Sarpa Satra of Janamejaya, one of the descendants of Pandavas. Janamejaya comes, I think, 5th in the generation. And Ugrashravas was there, and then from there, when he made all Tirthatana, he went to see many, he went on pilgrimage, and then finally he appeared at the sacrifice of Shaunaka. Shaunakasya Maharshe He Dvadasya Varshe Satre. So there was a sacrifice going on for 12 years. So he went there, and then all the sages who were present there, they asked him, what have you seen? Where have you been? And then he said, well, I listened to this Mahabharata. And then the sages asked him, why don't you tell us the whole story? And this is how Ugrashravas Sauti narrated the whole story of Mahabharata.
Okay. We're almost at time, so there's just a couple of questions on still on Mahabharata. I think we'll take it. The first question is Sanskrit the only official language of Mahabharata?
Mahabharata originally was composed in Sanskrit. Yes. I don't understand the word official. You cannot say official in this case, but it was an epic. It was being composed. You know, there was, they say that there was this great war in Kurukshetra fought between Pandavas and Kauravas. And after this war was over, these Sutas, they composed a song on this war. And they started singing it. So the basic song that was composed was in Sanskrit. Sanskrit was the language of composition at that time. It was a spoken language, no doubt, for some time. Then it ceased from being a spoken language. But the poem was, because the earliest manuscript reference, and there are several hundred manuscripts of Mahabharata, minimum 1300 manuscripts have been discovered. They are all in Sanskrit. And they are all in, you know, spread over about, say, 15 centuries or even more. And then what happened is that in different regions, Mahabharata was rendered in regional languages also. So we have, for instance, in Marathi we have Mukteshwara's Mahabharata. We also have Bengali Mahabharata. We have Tamil Mahabharata. We have Telugu and different, you know, regional Mahabharata. But they came subsequently. They were kind of adaptations We also have a Javanese Mahabharata in Java also. And we also have a translation of Mahabharata into Persian, which was commissioned by Akbar. A complete translation of Mahabharata.
The last question is in its essentials, how is Jaya different from Mahabharata?
Jaya is the original basic version, they say, and it tells us only of the story of the victory. Jaya, as the word itself suggests, it is the story of the victory of Pandavas over Kauravas. So it was limited only to the story of the war and victory. And then comes Bharata, where we have many, many accounts, many, many stories about the kings, their dynasties, all the kings belonging to Bharata Vamsha, and therefore it is Bharata. So this is how Jaya is supposed to be the original seed of Mahabharata.
Okay. All right. We are a little bit over time today. Thank you all for joining, and thank you, Dr. Bhatte.
We'll
see everyone again next Sunday. Thank you.
Thank you.